Good evening, everyone. My name is Michael Ulrich, and I'm the director of NYU Washington, DC. It is my pleasure to welcome you tonight to the Abramson Family Auditorium for tonight's Salon Series, a conversations with Zadie Smith and Jeffrey Eugenides, moderated by Keli Goff. The NYU Washington, D.C. Salon Series, Conversations with Writers and Artists, presents an opportunity for the NYU and Washington, D.C. community to meet and engage in dialogue with acclaimed writers and artists as they reflect on their craft. I want to thank Deborah Landau, director of the NYU Creative Writing Program in the College of Arts and Sciences. Through collaboration with the NYU Creative Writing Program, we are delighted to present these two internationally award-winning authors to you tonight, and I'm sure you may have heard of them. Zadie Smith is known for her treatment of race, religion, and cultural identity, and her novels, eccentric characters, savvy humor, and snappy dialogue. She became a sensation in the literary world with the publication of her first novel, White Teeth, in 2000. She began writing poems as a child and later studied English literature at the University of Cambridge. While there, she began writing White Teeth, and at age 21, NYU DC students, pay attention, she submitted some 80 pages to an agent. A frenzied bidding war ensued, and the book eventually was sold to Hamish Hamilton. She took several more years to complete the novel, and in 2000, it was published to rave reviews. The ambitious work won numerous awards, including the White Bread First Novel Award, and was a finalist for the National Book Critics, Circle Critics Award and the Orange Prize for Fiction. Much like his character, Calliope Stephanides, Jeffrey Eugenides was born to a Greek-American family in Grosse Pointe, a wealthy suburb of Detroit, Michigan. He graduated from Brown University, magna cum laude, and received his master's degree from Stanford University in English and Creative Writing. He is currently a professor of creative writing at Princeton University and has received many awards for his work, including fellowships from the Guggenheim Foundation and the National Endowment for the Arts, a Whiting Writers Award, and the Henry D. Vercel Memorial Award from the American Academy of Arts and Letters, and a little something called a Pulitzer Prize. Much of his work is set in Detroit, including both Middlesex and his earlier novel, The Virgin Suicides. I am pleased to introduce you to our moderator for the evening, Keli Goff. Keli is a journalist, author, playwright, screenwriter, and NYU alum from Gallatin. Currently a columnist for the Daily Beast, she is also the host of the new series, Political Party with Keli Goff, on NPR affiliate WNYC. Her work as a journalist has appeared in publications Time, Cosmopolitan, The Washington Post, and many others. The author of two books, she recently began writing for theater and television. She just completed a two-year fellowship with the famed Public Theater of New York and recently won an NAACP Image Award for her work on the critically acclaimed television series Being Mary Jane. She is a graduate of NYU Gallatin School of Individualized Study and Columbia University. Please join me in welcoming our panel.
So it's an honor to be here, and it's a pleasure to be here because I consider NYU and Gallatin the place where I really started getting my feet wet as a writer. And I'm also honored to be here because I'm such a fan of both of the two people I'm sitting here. You know, there's that famous saying that knowing whether you're the difference between being a writer and an author, in the company of these two people, I feel very much just like a writer. These people are authors, and I'm a huge fan of your work, so it's really exciting.
What's Gallatin School?
The Gallatin School of Individualized Study is a create-your-own curriculum school, or as I like to call it, and my parents do too, Montessori for grown-ups. So I had a lot of fun there, but I also learned a lot, and create your own curriculum. Mine was actually rather boring, of poli-sci theater and Africana studies. Other people do things like underwater basket weaving, sculpture, ballet, and economics. Mm-hmm. So Jeffrey, I wanted to start with you. In Middlesex, your Pulitzer Prize-winning novel, you explore this idea of nature versus nurture and identity. And I know that in a previous interview, you mentioned the idea of someone being born a writer genius is largely a myth. But I wanted to start by asking both of you, do you believe that you were born to write, or did your life experiences turn you into writers?
First of all, I want to say there's the nuclear security summit going on today. So I don't want to know. We're handling the tough questions tonight.
There'll be questions about that later. Yes.
I mean, you're born with certain abilities and certain interests that seem innate, but when I look back in my life, there was a fair amount of chance that brought me to writing and then made me decide to be a writer.
Such as?
Well, I mean, I remember writing as a kid and liking doing it quite a bit and being excited. They used to give a assignment where they would give you the first half of a story and you had to finish it in sixth grade, and I loved finishing these stories. I actually wish I could write my books the same way now. It's always the first half that gives me the trouble. And then in high school, I just had really wonderful English teachers, and also theater teachers. And I wanted to be an actor for a while, which I think is close to being a writer. And my parents were so worried about my becoming an actor. It seemed like such a bad idea that when I said I'd like to be a writer, it seemed like a safe, prudent idea.
They thought writing was a safe career path.
You got to start with something worse. You know, you got to say like I'm going to be a stripper, and then you move to the writing. So, I think back about it. Had I not taken the certain classes and lived in a certain town at that time, I might not have become a writer. I think innately I'm suited to it, but I wasn't definitely born to be one. It feels that way now.
What would you have done, do you think? Can you imagine?
When you put it that way, I think I really have to be a writer because I'm not suited for anything else.
Zadie?
The longer I do it, the more I think that there is some innate... I don't mean it as a compliment to writers. I think there are certain circumstances that repeat in the lives of writers. Or at least the more of them I meet, the more I feel this way. I've become a bit of an essentialist about it over the years just because you keep on... Comedians as well, I mm-hmm. gather them together, and actors a little bit. But one of the...
Some kind of suffering and things?
No, we've talked about this awkwardness. A book called The Drama of the Gifted Child, mm-hmm. which is a great book of psychology, and it notes that people who, for a living, make a habit of imitation, which I think is a lot of what writing involves, imitating mm-hmm. voices, imitating behavior, actors, obviously, comedians, obviously, will tend to have, and you don't have to answer this, Jeffrey, because to expose you, either a narcissistic mother or a very angry father. Mm-hmm. Or, if they're geniuses, mm-hmm. both. And the theory is partly that when you have a very narcissistic mother who is very different every day, you never know really what you're going to get, mm-hmm. that very small children have to respond very quickly to that person who comes into the room and gives you whatever they're giving you.
I'd like to be a genius, so I'll have to tell my mother to be more narcissistic. She's too nice.
But the one thing I like about the theory is it explains the reason why writers are always complimented, and actors and comedians, on their empathy, right? Supposedly they have this great gift of empathy, and yet writers themselves seem often quite miserable, sometimes suicidal, sometimes mm-hmm. drunk. So the argument that the empathy thing is really a kind of symptom rather than some wonderful gift.
Yeah.
Like learning to move very quickly in response to this person. Mm-hmm. Like, mum's angry today, I better deal with mum. Or mum's mm-hmm. manic today, I better deal with her this way.
Yeah.
So it looks like empathy, but it's just a mm-hmm. symptom of a child trying
survival tool, trying
to handle a situation.
Right.
And when I think of the writers I know, that makes much more sense to me than, oh, they're gifted with some miraculous inspiration thing which makes them wonderful people, because that's really not how it plays for the most part.
That makes me think that I really don't have that family dynamic at all, and maybe that's why I've always struggled to have sufficient empathy. I'm still working on it. I've been thinking about it lately in terms of writing characters, is that my tendency or my natural inclination is comic, and if I see someone, I think about a character, I want to think what's funny about the person, what's ridiculous in a way. And then the older I get and the more I think about people and trying to write characters, you know, people don't think of themselves as ridiculous. And if you continue to write with that notion in mind, I think that's a lack of empathy in a way, then you're going to have a satirical kind of work that, you know, it has its place, but it's not exactly what I want to do.
Maybe there's an ideal, like, I think we've talked about Nabokov a bit before, like something like Panin,
which
has an awareness that people are ridiculous, or their affect is ridiculous, but that's not the whole story of them. Like, being able to have that double consciousness in a narrative where you don't deny the fact that people are effectively flat characters a lot of the time. Mm-hmm. You know, they move through the world in a flat comic way, but trying to be aware of what's behind it. It's difficult to do both.
I'm actually glad you brought that up, because that gets us a couple pages ahead, but mm-hmm. since you brought it up, I wanted to ask, it seems to me that that writers often are, you know, categorized into either you're highbrow literary,
right.
or you're chick lit, or you're entertaining in a kind of way, and that a lot of serious art is often not created with the purpose of entertaining. So for instance, when I think of the movie 12 Years a Slave, which is a beautifully done film, but very haunting, and I doubt that when Steve was creating that work, he thought, my goal is to entertain. There's different ways people can consume art. Mm-hmm. And yet, one of the things you both have in common is that your books are without question serious literary fiction, and that they also have laugh out loud funny moments, mm-hmm. where if you're reading on a train, you start laugh, you know, there will be a moment where you'll laugh. Do you, when you set out to write your books, do you write them with the goal to entertain people? Is that something you're interested at all in doing? Or is that a relevant goal?
Like, when I'm thinking about it, I'm usually thinking about class. I actually been writing an essay for a long time about 12 years and the Tarantino movie, Django. Mm-hmm. And it was inspired by being in the lobby of my building when those movies were coming out and seeing all the doormen, there's a big group of doormen, talking incredibly excitedly about a movie, and I was really interested. Like, yeah. What are you talking about? What are you saying? They were reenacting, and I came close, and I realized it was Django. And they were thrilled by Django, and they were having a conversation about slavery, and I was talking to them, and I said, well, have you seen 12 Years a Slave? And they were like, no, I'm not going to go see that. That looks dull as hell. And I was thinking about the different modes of those movies. I love both of those movies intensely for different reasons, but I guess I'm always aware when I'm writing about this idea of taste as a matter of a certain amount of education, which is very problematic in a lot of ways. You know? If you come from a family like mine, I'm always aware when I'm writing, well, a lot of my family aren't going to read this. They're not going to read it. They can't read it, or they wouldn't read it, or it just would not fall into the realm of something they would read. And so that's always in my mind. And I guess when I think of like avant-garde or extremely intellectual writing, I know it's also a class matter in a certain case. You know, you create your audience, yeah. mm-hmm. and you have to be aware that the audience is formed in a certain way, goes through a certain system. So I guess I have an ideal that it must be possible to say even the most complicated things in an open way, in a way that collects everybody, or can collect almost everybody. Maybe another writer wouldn't care about that as a name, but it's always in my mind. It's not entertaining exactly, just open.
Accessible.
Yeah.
I don't think... I think about entertaining the reader very, very much, but I'm always very concerned about holding the reader's attention and interest, and the kind of experience that I want to give with my books is the readerly experience I've had with books. I just, you know, I can't stop reading the book. That's a kind of entertainment, but it's not a plot entertainment necessarily, and it's not just a kind of, I don't know, escapism. There's some deep emotional involvement and intimacy I have with a book that I am really connecting with. And that's what I think about. I want it to be readable. I don't want it to be needlessly difficult. Mm-hmm. I want it to be just as difficult as it needs to be to cover the subject. So I don't want to pander in any way, but I'm very happy to make it, you know, to make the path through the book as easy and pleasurable and engrossing for the reader as I can. So I think about that all the time.
Do you think that makes you... I mean, I'm not trying to get you in trouble with any of your friends or peers, but do you think that makes you rare? Because I certainly do, you know, get that impression in the different worlds we all move through as a writer, that there are some people who take great pride in the idea that only certain will read their book.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how they see it. It's not that it's not that not a lot of people read my book. It's that a certain type of person appreciates mm-hmm. my books. Mm-hmm. And if people find them too hard to read, then those are not the right kinds of people to be reading my work anyway.
Is that true? But I try not to be, because I think sometimes some of those experiments, like I teach a book called David Markson called Reader's Block, which is from like the mid 90s, and it's made almost entirely of literary quotation. It's almost like a homemade Google of mm-hmm. like 19th and 20th century literature. If you are not educated in that canon, the book is literally not legible in a certain mm-hmm. sense. Like, mm-hmm. it wouldn't be meaningless to you as you read it. But I feel when I'm reading that he's trying to make explicit what is always true when we're reading, that certain communities form around a book. When I'm reading Jeffrey's book, I will have a knowledge about a certain amount of it. I might not know Detroit. There might be some part of Detroit which is blocked from me, whereas the reader who's from Detroit, born and bred, or even of Jeffrey's exact age from that area, has a different relationship with that book. So you're always being blocked off in different ways. So I try and... I don't get, like, angry at the avant-garde, which is very determined to create a narrow space, but The thing I do find annoying is the idea that emotion, as Jeffrey said, or to be compelled or subsumed by a book is in some way inherently anti-intellectual. That I do not find to be the case. The whole person reads the book, and that's the person I want, the brain and everything else.
Well, it's interesting because I think on the surface, people would look at the two of you and assume, you know, that your writing may not have as much in common because you have such different backstories. But when I was, as someone who's reading both of your work and has read your work, I kind of was struck by the fact that you both do such a great job with depicting, I guess the trendy word now is the other, people who have experiences as the other. And so in Middlesex, the lead character is a hermaphrodite. You depict a number of characters who are from mixed race families or multiracial. And so I was wondering, do you think that your background, the fact that you come from an immigrant family and then went to an elite prep school, you were from a mixed race family yourself, do you think that in some ways, I guess the only term I could think of to describe it, do you think that that imbued you with the ability to be culturally bilingual and that that shows up in your work in a way that had you not had the experiences that you have, you would not be?
I think it's broader than cultural bilingualism. I think the ultimate artistic instinct is to know that your life is contingent, is to have some sense that it could have been otherwise. And it just happens if you're born, say, to one black parent and one white parent. It's really obvious that life could have been otherwise. You could have been white, you could have been black, they could never have met. The accidental nature of your life is kind of like front and center. But everybody's life is like that, wherever they're from. It's all accidental. You didn't have to be born in London or Washington or Houston. It's all contingent. But I feel like the artist is a person who, for whatever reason in childhood, is made very aware that things could have been otherwise. Something else could have happened. And that's like an exemplary narrative instinct.
I just thought of an answer to your other question, why you become a writer. Because I think in writing about the other, which I typically do, and someone who feels like a misfit, I think that's what makes a person a writer. At a certain impressionable age, you feel like a misfit and you become a spectator of life for whatever reason, and it ends up, you know, being, depending on what art you choose, maybe writing, maybe acting, maybe something else. But that's what I think did it for me. In terms of being culturally bilingual, what I have is, I can't remember who said this, but they said the poets come from the low class or the upper class, and that novelists come from the middle class. And what I have from my family is a large range of experience in terms of not race, obviously, but class. My mother was very poor, grew up in Kentucky, kind of rural people. And I've learned a lot about her family recently that I didn't even know. That they actually came to the country in 1650 and wandered around through the Cumberland Gap and things like that. So they go back to the States a long time. And then the other side is Greek immigrants. So I have connection just from growing up with poor Southerners, with immigrants from Greece, and then because of the school I went to with rich people, and as my father prospered with a more upper middle class life. So I saw a large range of what it was like to live with different means. And I think that's been useful, or will, you know, continue to be useful to draw on.
I guess I'm just pondering that. Well, actually, I'm pondering the fact of how much of being a misfit turned me into a writer, too. Yeah. You've given me something to think about. One of my favorite lines you've written, well, actually that anyone's written, but you happen to write it, is in your essay on Their Eyes Were Watching God, where you write, white novelist or not white novelist, but simply novelist, and white characters or not white characters, but simply human. Do you think we will ever get to a point in which the work of women writers and black writers and the characters they create will be judged just as such?
I mean, just as... It's already happening. It's all a matter of just seeing more and more of it. And I think perhaps it's hard if you've been part of a dominant culture for a very long time to make that leap of imagining yourself into somebody else's life. To be part of a minority culture is to do that every day, mm-hmm. because there's just no other way of operating in the world. You're watching the Brady Bunch or whatever, and you're aligning yourself with the Brady Bunch, even though you and the Brady Bunch got nothing to do with it. So you're always involved in that way. And I think it can be hard just because of a long period of thinking of yourself as a central subject of everything. There was that hilarious SNL video recently about the Beyoncé song formation, when all these white people are freaking out, and one of them says, "It doesn't seem to be for us, but everything was for us." That feeling, I think, is shocking in some way. But I don't think of it as a revenge, or I think it's such a healthy feeling to be decentered. It's a creative, exactly what Jeffrey said about not belonging. It's an incredibly creative feeling. So it's something that I never felt victimized by. I felt I was lucky. It's a kind of gift. And when you're around people who have extreme cases of it, I think mostly of stand-ups. I love stand-up comedians. My brother is a stand-up. They're really the extreme case, you know, that they go through life feeling this absolute alienation. I walked into the Comedy Cellar recently to see a show, and the guy stood up and said, "You're the first people I've spoken to today." I love that idea.
Yeah.
So that is kind of extreme life, right? This incredible loneliness, and then this like objectification or like performance of your isolation to other people. But I like people like that. I'm attached to them, and I don't know. I grew up that way.
Well, let me ask you about a larger conversation about the diversity issue. Why does it seem that the face of sort of, you know, serious literary writing in America is still seen as predominantly white, predominantly male, or at least perceived that way, when we have you, we have Toni Morrison, we have Alice Walker, we have a whole litany of serious fiction writers who break that mold? And so I guess my question is this a perception issue, or is it still a real issue? And is it that there are gatekeepers at major publishers or among the major critics who cannot get themselves to see beyond that mold?
Yeah, in America, I don't actually perceive it that way. I see a huge African diaspora of writing at the moment, which is really exciting to me. To me, American publishing at the book side of things is pretty diverse. Publishing itself is a different matter.
Right.
And in England, it's a different matter. Like, in England, black writing is really struggling still. And me and, I guess, Monica Ali and a few other people who published in 2000, 2001, I guess we have felt this was going to be the beginning of something, and it really has not been the beginning of anything. There is this African diaspora of writing, but they're wonderful writers, but they're all like upper middle class African writers. Mm. But black, British, working class writers, that's not a thing that's happening in Britain.
So then, I'm so glad you said that, because the next part of my question was going to be, do you see, how does the issue of class affect who is writing what? Because I know in journalism, I actually think people outside of journalism are not as aware of how much class is shaping.
It's not a conspiracy. It's part of the structure of the thing. The great working class monument is music, because music doesn't need a narrow part. You don't need to speak a certain way. Or the working class community has made a monument to last the ages. Hip-hop, rock, music in general, pop music. It's absolutely exquisite. It's a masterpiece. But literature has this narrow path because it is a written form of a certain kind. It needs good schools and good universities. There is always the outsider writer, but the truth is it's one in a million. Mm. You need an education to write, and at least in Britain, the educational system is rigged. So if you're expecting working class black British writers to appear, where do you think they're going to come from? From what universities are they going to appear? I was one of like three black girls at Cambridge. Like, where are these writers going to spring out from the air? It's not going to happen. But they continue, despite all odds, to be incredible musicians, incredible hip-hop artists. In every form where you don't need money or a degree, their creativity will be clear. But it's not going to spontaneously appear. The schools have to change. Oh, that's how I feel.
Jeff, do you have any thoughts on the diversity issue?
I do. I was thinking from the other side of it, with the formation video. You know, that this doesn't seem to be for us. So if I grew up as a white person, thinking that everything's for me, what's going on now as a male when I read women writers, for instance, what it is like a huge expansion of my knowledge about the world. You know, what I've learned from reading Alice Munro about what it is like to be a woman is this wonderful thing. I didn't do it till late in my life. I grew up reading mostly male authors, and then little by little stopped reading so many male authors. And you know, it was that you can apply that to any new set of people who's writing. It's like a great addition to what's happening. And what's going on now is definitely, I mean, I think there's not just human experience that's white. I think people are quite able to read a book by anyone and take that to be just as relevant to their lives as anything else. I mean, that's what we're learning to do. That's where the culture is going, and it's an expansion that's great.
I will tell you though, I was just reading, just not just in prep for this, but in general, a women's site, and in the comments they were weighing in on a controversy at a particular school regarding a specific professor, and I don't want to go down that path because that's not what the conversation's about, but in the comment section there was a lot of talk about how it is still perceived among those who are literature majors as it being easier to be seen as the genius up-and-coming young white male writer. Mm. Now, those aren't the programs I was in, but these women seem to feel very strongly that this situation's still rigged. And one of them even wrote in the comment section that she said, perfect example, my professors would give, you know, males who were doing just as well in the class their contacts at specific publications, and they would say, oh, you know, maybe you should consider a different path. Do you think that that's still, and I'm, for me, it that's why I asked about, is it perception or is it reality? Is there still a
reality? I can't say what their perception is and when the amount of reality is. I know my classes are almost all women.
Mine too.
You know, so I mean, the future of writing, as far as I can see, is not male, because none of my students are male, very few of them. Right. And is there, I mean, mentorship is something that's come up a lot this year at Princeton because of the Black Justice League and the different protests, because a lot of the African-American students didn't feel like there was mentorship for them. And it made me think, like, do I act differently with a male student, and does he feel more comfortable coming to me and being mentored by me? I haven't noticed it. Most of my students that I have advised their theses, it's almost all women, and I don't see that happening, but I'm not them. I don't know how it feels to them. This is just Princeton, and this is just a certain student body. So, you know, if they're feeling that, there must be some basis for their experience.
Or maybe it's what you're both talking about, that we really are at a turning of the tide, in the same way that women now outnumber men on college campuses. Yeah. But you don't see we're not going to see the real impact on wider society for another few years when they're out there.
Like, receptions historically, like thinking about Jewish writers in the 40s and 50s, the way that Bellow first and then Roth were, every article you read about them, if you go to New York Times in the 40s and 50s, made it incredible. They were Jewish writers, Jewish first and foremost. They were like this minor part of an American canon.
Right.
And they wrote their way out of that, you know? It took 40 years, but no, they are still writers who are Jewish, but nobody thinks of them as Jewish. They are American writers, or writers of the first order.
No, they're just sexist white male
writers.
So that's a sign of success for them, I guess.
It's quite striking, like, thinking about the reaction to something like Portnoy's Complaint, which was so outraged, not just from kind of moral America, but from Jewish America, you know? Like, he got 1,000 letters saying, you're letting the team down, we're ashamed of you, your mother's ashamed of you, everyone's ashamed of you. So it takes a while, you know? Mm-hmm. It's always a shock when this new voice appears. And then it becomes institutionalized, people read it, many people read it, people love it, and you get all the way, as Jeffrey says, to becoming like the big bad guy at the 50 years down the line. That's how writing works. Right. So
we only have one American Nobelist now, and it's Toni Morrison. It's not a man. So.
Well, let me ask you this, because Zadie was mentioned this in terms of England, but I'd really love to hear your thoughts, if you have any, in terms of America on the class issue in writing. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know if you've noticed, but sometimes it's hard financially to make it as a writer.
Yeah.
That's, so I've heard. But
In all the arts. I mean,
if
you look at visual artists, it's very bad, because it costs a lot to have a studio. So a lot of these people who are able to move to Williamsburg get a studio and do work. They're all rich kids.
But I'll offer a confession. One of the reasons I wanted to ask Jeff is that for me, I've really felt and seen it getting worse in the last 5 years, 5 to 10 years, in that I've really reflected on whether or not I could have had the career I've been able to carve out for myself and live in New York had I started 5 years ago as opposed to 8 years ago.
Right.
Like, I really feel like, and that's a concern to me, because, you know, when you think about the voices we need to impact culture and the conversations that we have that bring about social change, those come from writers and visual artists and journalists. And so I'm wondering if you have any thoughts about what could we could be doing differently to make sure that we're not abandoning all of our creative arts to people who can afford to have their parents subsidize them in Williamsburg for the 4 years they're trying to make it.
It's a social justice issue, though. Like, I don't know, in America it's different, but for me and my husband, both educated for free, went to Cambridge for free, and then very soon after, we were both published. And we look, that's 20 years ago now. If I look back on that route, as you say around here, it's practically, it is impossible now. You have to pay for university now in England. That happened 6 years ago, whatever, 7 years ago. The kind of school I went through is crumbling. Or I mean, the actual school I went to, the riot police were called in 4 years ago. You know, it's that whole system is not there anymore, this kind of meritocratic, state-funded system. Mm. So, again, I understand people get angry with publishing, to me it's a structural issue. You can't expect people to arrive at the end point if there's no route through. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. Part of it is having students who are willing to involve themselves when they graduate from university in that kind of work, you know, who aren't going straight to the law firms or, you know, who are willing to involve themselves.
Well, do you find in this country that, do you think that we devalue the arts? And that's part, because
you don't know you're born. All these Guggenheims, Yaddo, whatever, it's incredible here. Like, artists, once they're on that track, can exist.
No, I guess what I meant is that if someone went into a low-income neighborhood and said, we need more people like you to go into STEM programs, everyone would applaud it and say, let's pour money into it. But you go into a low-income neighborhood and say, we really need voices like yours writing.
It's not. And also, I don't, like, for instance, I don't have almost any black students anymore, and I did 6-7 years ago, because kids from maybe second generation backgrounds or their parents are saying to them, well, definitely not creative writing. And who can blame them?
I have the same situation.
Who can blame them in this economy? Who would do that?
They get into prison and then they go and they go to investment banks or something. I have very few students.
I wouldn't, like, when I was in university, it was the mid-90s, there was money everywhere. When I said to my mother, I want to be a writer and my brothers want to be rappers, she was like, fine. You know, it was the mid-90s, it didn't matter. Nobody's doing that now. It's just not possible.
Well, you mentioned your family, so I'll go ahead and ask this then. I know that you mentioned once, Jeff, that there was some stuff that you revisited before Middlesex was published because you worried it might sting your family.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk about finding the balance between writing your truth and also, you know, but allowing people the space to kind of protect their truths as they see it? Because I've grappled with that, I think, any writer who's ever. I've had a couple of essays where I picked up the phone right before I went to the editor.
That's why I like it says fiction on the fronts of my books. Yeah, I can always, you write what you have to write, and you're merciless about it. I had one family detail in Middlesex that my editor asked me, did I need it? And would it cause trouble? And I didn't need it, and I took it out. I'm glad I took it out. But if it was crucial, I'm going to go with the story that I need to write. People get angry at you, but they usually get over it. I've written about people. I have people who hate me because they've seen themselves in my books, but they're free to, you know, put me in a book and make me look awful. I can handle that, you know. If they need to do it, they can do it. I think most novelists know that, you know, this is how it works, and you have to be forgiving.
Which is why you don't date novelists.
You don't break up with them.
And certainly not on bad terms.
No.
Well, that actually made me think of Susan Shapiro, who's a writing coach, and I know she's taught at NYU before. And she used to tell this story about how someone in her family, who's a plumber, she'd mentioned writer's block, and the person was like, honey, there's no such thing as plumber's block. You got to do your job, you know? And so, which I thought was such a funny, like, oh, okay, right. Have either one of you ever grappled with, I mean, I know every writer has moments where it's hard to write, but have either of you really struggled? And if so, is there a secret for how we get through it?
At the moment, it's much more practical. Like, I was saying to Jeff backstage, I've lost my childcare, so that's my writer's block. Like, I can work from 9 till 2, and then I'm effectively blocked because I got nowhere to go. Nothing I can do, so I have to. But it can be quite productive, those kind of things. You know, if you know you've only got 4 hours, you got to make those 4 hours really work. I did have, I think, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, just, I think it's depression really is what it is. You just, you can't see any, it's not that I don't have ideas, it's just that I can't see anything that I'm writing is of any worth. I would call that a blog.
Yeah, that's, can't get out that's, of it. I'm terrible that way. I have a lot of indecision. Yeah. So I write and rewrite it and get tired of it and go on to something else and have a bright idea, that then that starts to look bad and I go back to the other one, go back and forth. Years pass while I'm doing this, and then I get very upset about it. So I write in a constant state of writer's block that's productive because I'm churning pages out, but often it's not conclusive.
How do you find your way out of it?
I'm really trying. I think it's a deep psychological problem I have, and I'm trying to fix it before I die.
It's really painful. And to think that, I mean, I'm 40 now, you just don't expect to still have those feelings. You think,
One day.
It's got to not be like that. I'm going to sit down and write with more pleasure at least. But it's the way it is.
I just read an article about Tiger Woods trying to figure out what happened to Tiger Woods.
When the mojo goes.
Yeah, and getting the yips at, you know, doing his short game. And
horrifying.
Like, it really is like writing. If something gets in your head and you get spooked and you think you can't do it, you know, no matter what you're doing as a human being, you can really lose your ability to do something. The confidence that you need has to be there, and yet it can't be egocentric at the same time. So it's a difficult balance.
Well, so let me ask you this. I know that for other forms of writing, whether it's screenwriting, certainly in journalism, social media has had a profound impact, and in many ways not a good impact, right? Because it's whether or not people are worried about saying something that might possibly offend someone to the extent that it paralyzes any of the in-depth conversation that needs to happen on particular subjects, or whether it's the fact that one person who has, you know, one Twitter follower can write something devastatingly brutal about a particular piece, and it reverberates in this way that's picked up massively. And so I know it's literally a conversation at the upper echelons and other forms of writing, but I'm wondering about in the literary world. Are you immune to that? Is that stuff, does it impact in any way?
If you want to ruin your day's writing, and I think it's deliberate, you're going to do it deliberately. If you go online and search for stuff about yourself, it's like you might as well be cutting yourself. It's self-harm. And you'll stop. You won't write that day, and you might not write that week or that month or 6 months. So I don't do it anymore, just because I can't even let a little bit of it in. So I'm not involved in social media in any way. It's just pure survival. Like I want to do my work, and also perhaps like egotism. Like you want to do your work so bad that you don't do that stuff. It's not like I have such great willpower. It's just I want to do this more than anything else, so everything else has to not happen.
Yeah, I'm not connected to it at all, and it's because I'm just doing something else. It's not even much of a decision.
Do you think it's affecting the literary world at all?
Yeah. Well,
to people that are doing it are getting messed up by it probably.
Completely. Once upon a time you'd write a book, and of course people had opinions. There were reviews, and you met people in the flesh who would. But the idea of writing something, an article, and then finding out in 1 minute what 50,000 people think of it, is a demented procedure if you want to try and write. I mean, it's just, you can't write under that feedback loop. And you start seeing the writing responds to the feedback loop, which is the most depressing part of it.
I'm getting scared even hearing about this. I didn't know this existed, really. I knew it's out there somewhere. But
the interesting thing about pulling back from it, like I totally, thumbs up to the kids who can do it. They've got tough skins or whatever they've got. But I think of the way I write as like I'm kind of like a slow food movement. So Beyonce's video happens and 50 billion people write about it. I might write about it in 4.5 years when I finally decided what it is I think about the video. It takes me a while. And I just got used to thinking that that's okay. Like, you don't have to have a response 10 seconds after something happened.
Yeah, because
it's not that important.
I'm in total agreement. And it took me, I went cold turkey kind of by default a couple years ago because I had a job in a writer's room on a show in LA. And so I just couldn't be online. And guess what? The world didn't stop.
Right.
My career didn't end. You know, in fact, it was really funny. My editor was like, you know, your columns have actually been doing better. So I thought, well, maybe people just needed not to hear from me.
Right.
to enjoy the work. But I offer the disclaimer that I don't read what people say about me online, but my mother does.
Yeah, my mother reads everything. But it's not about, like, you don't have to be a Luddite. It's just, for me, it's just a question of pleasure and happiness. I want to be happy. And I avoid things that make me unhappy.
And you're actually doing the work.
That's the kind of person I am. I don't like to be unhappy.
And you're actually doing the work because something that, you know, not that anyone's asked for my advice here, but what I've noticed, especially with younger writers who feel they must do that 60% of the time to promote the work they're working on 40% of the time.
Right.
And you could be doing so much more writing if you weren't doing that stuff. And what I found for me is it stopped even being about the criticism or all of that, but it's like what you said is I just was too busy. And if I have a choice between updating a Facebook account or finishing another article, I'm going to finish another article or finish a play or finish something else.
But I think maybe we don't have, like, I don't have the panic like someone like Franzen has, because I reckon every generation figures it out. Like when I was 11, I watched 7.5 hours of TV a day. I don't do that anymore. I grew up, I was like, yeah, maybe I don't want to watch 7.5 hours of TV a day. I'll just watch half an hour. So I think the same thing will happen.
My daughter is off most social media. She's 17. She's gotten, you know, I think she was swept up in it a few years ago, and now she's not. So I think her generation might define itself by being a little bit skeptical of all of
this. I've heard that the pullback is starting already.
Yeah, I think so.
So I figured we could kind of, before we open it up to Q&A, is just do a little bit of a rapid fire round. Okay. You can say pass if you'd like. So we've been talking about the trauma of writing. What's your favorite mode of procrastination?
Reading the New York Times on my phone.
That's a good one. Zadie?
Well, it used to be smoking. I loved smoking.
Now it's an e-cigarette?
That's so literary, though.
I know. It was so great, though. It was the perfect solution to everything apart from cancer. So I've given it up. And now it's awful. I chew the plastic tops of bottles.
Better than cigarettes.
But it just spends the time.
The moral fixation. Favorite book you've read?
Ever?
Uh-oh. Well, yes, ever. Now I'm determined about it.
Well, my go-to is always Anna Karenina. If you want to pick a novel that I love,
the same. That's shameful. I've got the same one.
I mean, it's. But.
Do you have a guilty pleasure book that people would be surprised to know that you read and enjoy?
No, I'm not very highbrow in many of my tastes, but I don't have the guilty pleasure book that I keep secret. They're mostly decent books, the ones I like. So. I like Lolita. I'm sorry about.
Yeah. That's the same. I have guilty TV shows.
Yeah.
Oh,
songs.
Okay. How about guilty TV show?
I love Empire, for example, but I don't like bad books. I don't get pleasure out of them. They just annoy me.
I worked out and watched two episodes of Better Call Saul last night, which I think is really good, though. I think that's extremely good. But I watched Shark Tank, if you want to know that.
Oh, that's a good answer.
Dragon's Den in India.
Favorite book you've written?
My first book is the one that's dearest to me for whatever reason. I think because I didn't know.
Virgin Suicides?
Yeah, The Virgin Suicides, because I didn't know that I was going to write it. No one was waiting for it. Mm-hmm. It was a kind of a purity about the experience of writing it, and whatever its flaws, it's not something that they don't bother me. The other ones, I think back, and what could I have done? But that one seems like it came out just in an innocent way. So that's my favorite.
Zadie, a favorite book you've written?
And my next one, of course.
Yeah, that's
whatever
how
that
I feel.
Is.
That's
the
I
one
feel.
That's going to really
the one
work.
I'm finishing, to be honest. Apart from that, there's a little one called The Embassy of Cambodia. That's the one that makes me feel least sick.
that's the right answer. Yeah.
Really?
That's the truth. That's the truth.
Yeah, they do. They haunt you in a terrible way.
That's the one I like. Yeah.
Do you go back and read your books?
Only if they are paying me to do it.
Yeah, out loud, for money.
Favorite character you've created?
Probably Calliope in Middlesex, because it's it contains so much. I find
that so much of a happier question for some reason. Yeah. Do you? I feel I have lots of good feelings about characters. I really like Fatu in Embassy of Cambodia, Kiki in On Beauty, Archie in White Teeth. I feel much better about that question.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Can they edit out the other one?
Yeah.
We like our people. Okay.
People. Yeah, people are cool.
And lastly, if there's someone who's listening right now who dreams of being a writer, what advice do you have for them?
Jeff.
Well, I agree with Zadie that the path is narrow at the beginning. There's a lot of work to be done and reading to be done, and you have to write every day and get used to the discipline of it. It used to be, I would sit down for an hour, and I'm going to write for an hour, and it seemed painful at first, and now I don't even notice it. So that's what you need to do. Write as much as possible and read as much as possible. And don't do Twitter.
Yeah. Good piece of advice.
The reading is a huge part. I used to think that's all it was, just reading, just being an obsessive reader, just like being a good comic is knowing everything about comedy. But I do think as you get older, I see more the American idea, like that Hemingway idea of living, because the little bits of living I do are so useful. Like, even a little trip anywhere, I'm amazed how, I know that sounds so stupid. I mean, it's obvious that if you travel, it will be helpful, and if you have a life, it will be helpful. But that wasn't obvious to me when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to sit in a room, read and write. I didn't want to do anything. Didn't want to exercise, didn't want to meet anyone, didn't want to do anything. So at being grown, I've just noticed, like I spent a lot of time in West Africa recently, and nothing could have replaced that. I couldn't have got it out of a book. I could, there's no way. Like, just being there amongst people in a village, it was incredible for me. It, just so useful for writing. And it's taken me a long time to work that out, but got there in the end.
You know, because I'm older, I feel like I've reached a point of having a Proustian backlog. Like, if I just go into my attic room where I write now and never leave...
Memories.
I have enough to write about now. There's so much I haven't done. I don't need anything else to happen to me.
Yeah.
At all. But I needed something, and something did. And so it'll take me the rest of my life to figure it out.
So with that, we'd like to open it up to questions. There's someone up there with a microphone, if anyone wants to raise
Georgia.
Your hand.
Sorry, it's a friend of mine. Sorry, carry on.
Hi.
Oh, it's you. We're going to ask a question.
I just finished reading Big Magic by Elizabeth Gilbert.
Right.
And one of my favorite parts of the book, she talks about an idea she had for a book. And she sort of let the idea go because life happened.
Right.
When she came back to the idea, she, in conversation with another writer, realized that writer was working on that same idea now and had gotten it published. And so I'm curious as to whether you've lost ideas to other writers.
It just happened to me. Oh. Me and my husband were writing a TV show about Hollywood in the 30s, about Irving Thalberg and Louis B. Mayer, like disguised, but that whole world. And the idea was about a young black actor trying to make it in Hollywood at that time. It was a very stressful period for black actors. And the kids came along. Georgia knows my kids. And we sat on it for a while, and we thought we'd take it somewhere. And then finally, 2 weeks ago, we thought, let's take it somewhere. And we took it to, I think, Netflix. And they were incredibly excited. And then we opened, like, Variety, and someone is making that exact show.
Oh,
it's a pilot. Unbelievable.
That doesn't seem to stop them.
It's incredible to me. But it's, in a way, it's kind of, it makes you feel good because you think, oh, well, that must have been
a good idea.
Good idea.
Right.
And for some reason, that period and that situation between those two men is interesting. Mm-hmm. But I couldn't believe, it's never happened to me before. It's just the entire idea, the same years, the same plot, everything.
I'll tell you what happened to me. It's that when I was writing Middlesex, which is about an intersex person, there was another writer who lived not far away who I found out was also... No, she found out that I was writing about that subject, and she was writing a book also about something with hermaphroditism connected to it. And she called... and she asked, like, how far along are you?
Oh, God!
And I said, oh, I'm almost finished. And 6 years later, I finally finished. But I scared her. I scared her off the subject.
That's amazing.
Thank God, so that it would be mine. You live in fear of that, though.
It happens in journalism all the time. Too.
Yeah, it must always. Yeah.
Slow by a day.
Oh,
I'm picking? Oh. Okay, sorry. There's someone over here who's had her hand up.
Could you possibly pass this?
And I'm sure you guys are a well-behaved crowd, so I don't need to say this, but I'm going to. Questions, not comments, or monologues, or soliloquies, please.
Hi, I'm just wondering, what's your writing ritual like? Do you, is there like a set of things you need to do before you finally sit down and write, or do you just have to kind of force yourself to sit down for you in your attic and just like write?
I think it really is a luxury of young people, this idea of rituals. Or I don't know what you're talking about. I get the kids in school and I go to the library. There's no... The ritual is there a nanny? That's the ritual. is there childcare today? There's nothing else. Nothing else happens.
My daughter lives with me, but she's 17, as I said, so she deals with, you know, she goes to school and takes care of herself. I just go upstairs and work when I wake up. It's very simple.
But you definitely work on your writing every day.
Yeah, definitely, as much as I can. Not, you know. It's terrible. I don't want to do anything else. We were talking about Knausgård, and you know, he doesn't like holidays. He doesn't like take vacations. I feel like that. I mean, it would be great. The greatest thing to do on Christmas would be to finish a book, actually,
right.
Not to open presents.
Right.
That's another reason you shouldn't go out with a writer. There's a lot of reasons.
Hi. You talked a little bit about the sort of lack of diversity, but do you think we are missing something from having not that many books translated from other countries here in America? It's hard to, you have to really look for, you know, books in translation.
Yeah, I think that's the biggest problem. In England, I think it's even more extreme than here. It's like an incredibly tiny percentage. Every time I have had like archipelago books, I don't know if you know them, they specialize in this, and every time I pick up one of their books, it is really like a world opening up. There's an amazing one from Greece at the moment.
I didn't read it yet.
So good, about the voices from the collapse of Greece, basically, past year. So it's these things like that. It's just incredibly expanding. So for me, it's the big things that have mattered to me recently, I guess, Knausgård and Elena Ferrante, they have been in translation.
Yeah, I think that's our biggest problem as well. When I lived in Europe for 5 years, what I liked about it was that I felt I heard from so many different countries. And when you come back to the States, I mean, all you hear about is Donald Trump. You don't hear about anything else that's going on. And the really important things are happening right now in Turkey and it's that way literarily as well. We don't hear enough from the outside.
There's someone here in the front in yellow.
Hi. Who's your favorite living artist, sculptor, photographer, painter?
Visual artist?
Visual artist, uh-huh. Yeah. Living.
I love Gerhard Richter, the German painter. He's somebody I really admire, and I probably would pick him.
I have to think about it. I don't know.
I'll just say why I like him while she's thinking. he's mastered so many different styles. He can paint realistic portraits of a candle. He's done abstracts by wiping the canvases. He's done amazing large paintings of Madrid just using white and black. I like that because he didn't just get one idea and endlessly repeat it. He keeps changing his mode, and yet if you look at it in totality, it all does seem to emanate from one person. I've always felt badly about myself because I have very different impulses in my books, and they're not really like each other. I keep doing something different, and I felt that was maybe a defect. So when I see someone like Gerhard Richter, I feel a little bit better about myself.
I don't know if I have a good answer. I'm thinking of all the things I've been to see recently, they're all really long dead. I do look at a lot of, I just went to see the Van Dyke, so that's all I can think of right now is how extraordinary the Van Dyke was. I know the artists I know a little bit, like Kara Walker I really love. But I guess I'm a bit backwards looking in the visual arts, shamefully.
I like Glenn Ligon a lot, and I have a lot of artist friends. I think they're all really great, like Thomas DeMond, the photographer, and Tessa Dedeen, a fellow Brit. And Mark Wallinger, I think, is a wonderful conceptual artist as well.
Here's one way at the back.
For each of you, do you have a particular kind of scene that you like writing, like party scenes or internal monologues? And are there particular kinds of scenes that you try to avoid writing unless it's really necessary for where you see the book going?
Go on, Jeff, you take it. That's a good question.
The hardest thing to write are scenes. They're extremely difficult to write. The more people you have in the scene, the harder it is. I'm fairly competent with prose and with a long paragraph. I usually can describe things and explain things, but to have the dramatic movement of a scene, to describe what people are saying and not, you know, and allow the reader to see what's happening, I find very difficult. So I don't have a favorite one. The easiest one for me to do is teenagers for some reason. When I do teenagers, male or female, I hear the voices more quickly. And I can get into those scenes. But if I stray into provinces where I don't know the people very well, then I have trouble and usually cut the scene out.
I definitely like meetings. I notice NW is almost entirely constructed between people meeting, you know, two people meeting, crossing.
Who haven't met before.
Sometimes
those are hard.
Different places. I like that a lot. I love domestic arguments. I love men and women shouting at each other. I think my childhood, that was the backdrop to every day of my life, and I've become very familiar with that structure. So I like that. But anything with dialogue, really, you know, I love to write dialogue. But I have the feeling that I have to try and control myself, because otherwise it kind of runs away with me. I don't want to write a book that's nothing but dialogue, but it's always a temptation. Yeah.
That's a great play.
Yeah, exactly. I should just write plain. Bother with a little bit.
Thank you both for your words. sorry. You both mentioned the importance of education. So, Jeffrey, you were talking about having really great teachers, and Zadie, you mentioned schools need to change. So I'm wondering, just in your experience, what's worked? Kind of what's scaffolded and supported you to get to where you are, and how can that be replicated and emulated elsewhere?
In my case, I was very moved. The kind of schools I went to were struggling. They're definitely struggling schools, you know. So the teachers in them who were dedicated to it, I was always very moved by the fact they were there. And I guess my parents were very like lefty activists, whatever. So they kind of made clear to me that certain teachers were doing it out of a political commitment, because that really was the truth. Like, I was taught in my secondary school by a guy who graduated from King's College, Cambridge. He sure as hell did not have to be teaching in an inner city school with 2,000 kids, who some of them got knives, and he didn't have to be doing that. Mm-hmm. And he was teaching us Keats, and he was doing all this kind of, you know, quite difficult work given the context. And I don't know, I was just moved by it. I was moved by the idea that somebody had taken the time. And I guess I was quite a bright student. I was always trying to, you know, make myself put myself in the teacher's way, like lingering, trying to like pick me or something. And I guess that was just my habit, to try and find the teacher who was doing it because of some crazed political idealism, and then just put myself forward as, what about me? So I don't know. I don't know if that's a replicable thing, but it definitely makes a huge difference to have committed teachers in difficult schools. I mean, anybody who's thinking about teaching, it changed my life, and you know, you feel so grateful to those people that they did that. I don't know how many people do that anymore, but it was a phenomenon, at least in London in the 80s, 90s, leftist teachers.
I had both. I had one great leftist teacher who was an English teacher, and he would always be wearing a black armband in support of some cause that we never understood what it was. He was always mourning something. And at the same time, he was extremely old-fashioned, almost fussy, and punctilious. He'd actually grown up in Brazil, but he had a kind of English accent. I could never understand how he came to be who he was. But he would have me come over to his house while he ironed, and then have me read aloud Tale of Two Cities to him. And just the fact of getting to go to a teacher's house, and him being interested and reading Dickens aloud for an hour or so had a huge effect on me. But on the opposite side, I had a Latin teacher who was not leftist at all. She would come into the class and we would have to stand up when she came as though she was the queen. And she referred to us as infants in a kind of endearing way, you know, but infants, and she would be so upset. So you go back and forth between this kind of lovely, almost like Pinochet-like person and a Che Guevara in English class. There was the oscillation that was interesting and helpful to me.
Hi. How often do you start something and not finish it?
That doesn't really happen to me. I recently gave up a novel, but I know I'll go back to it. I didn't get very far, and I switched to a different book. But
this is why I admire Zadie so much, is that she does things, and I see her just with dispatch finish them off and tackle them, and they come out, and her essays and her novels, and it's amazing to me, because I'm constantly starting things and then losing the nerve. I already lamented that. I'm not going to go on about it again. But it happens to me quite a bit. I usually get back to it. I'm persistent, but there's a lot of wrong turns in the middle of it.
Hi. You both mentioned the importance of reading and how it makes you a better writer, but how do you strike the balance between the time you spend reading versus the time you spend writing? Like, how do you know, maybe you're reading so much because you're procrastinating, maybe, or I don't know.
Since I had kids, my reading time has been demolished, and I really, because I had to make exactly that choice, like, realistically, what am I going to do in those 4 hours? And I've got to write, so I can't read. But I experience it as a massive loss. I think, at least when I was younger, I definitely thought of myself as a writer as a teenager and when I was in college, but the sum total of my work was about 3 short stories over, you know, 15 years. I wasn't writing, really. I was reading all the time, but I didn't journal. I didn't write at all. And the first big thing I wrote was White Teeth. So just from my experience, it's like 90% reading, you know, and then the writing is a response to the reading. Yeah.
Well, I got to college, I hadn't read, you know, that much, just the things they assigned us in school, and then I realized that, and I spent the next 20 years reading all the time. I think I don't read as much as I used to, because I have all of that already in my head, though I still read quite a bit, but There's got to be a segment of your life where the reading is probably, you're doing more reading than writing. But if you want to be a writer, obviously they can't go on forever.
Hi. Do you learn how to be an author through classes, or have you taught yourself?
I didn't. In England, we didn't have that kind of creative writing system, so that it was not an option.
That's why it took her to 22 to write a book.
But without my English degree, I don't think I would have become a writer. Not a serious one. I don't think so. That's, to me, what made it happen. Or maybe it would happen, but much would have taken longer. To me, it was like a kind of boot camp of a certain kind. Though, of course, you never write a word of fiction in 3 years. That's not what it was for. But it kind of... one of the things it does, that kind of survey course where you read everything, you know, 600 years worth of writing, is that you know what's been done. It's very helpful.
Very, if
you're trying to do,
yeah,
something,
yeah,
new, you're aware of what's come before, and you're not deluded about the newness of what you're doing. So you don't do some strange visual thing on the page and think, wow, this is so fresh.
Cause I just came up with this stream of consciousness thing.
Yeah, yeah, right. And I have students like that. They just aren't aware, yeah, of that modernism happened, or they think they've just invented something. So it's useful to know what came before. So I really did need that. And I don't teach workshop myself, but I can totally see the point of having other people read your stuff. And in unofficially, I did have that. Like, when I wrote White Teeth, I went on holiday to France with a load of friends, and they all read that manuscript, and they all worked on it. So that was effectively a writer's group. It's just, we were just friends, students together.
I teach workshops, and I've been in them a lot, so I shouldn't malign them too much, or I'd be out of a job. But most of what I've learned has been self-taught. I think every writer finally reads books and reverse engineers them and figures out how is this thing made, and you just teach yourself how to do it and how to write the books you're going to write that no one else is going to write. No one can tell you how to do that.
Can I ask a follow-up to that?
Yeah.
Do you think there's ever a point one reaches, because I've been asked this and I don't know the answer, so I'm going to toss it over to you two, where you know whether you, quote, have it or you don't? Is there ever a point where someone's been trying and trying and trying?
The only thing I can analogize it to is when I was young, I wanted to be a singer. And I think I have a good voice. It's a really nice voice. And I'd audition and do stuff. But it became clear to me, it was really painful recognition that what I was like an imitator. Like, I can do voices, I can sing like X or sing like Y or do an Ella Fitzgerald impression, but I was never going to be an artist. I don't mean that as a highly elevated term, but I just wasn't going to make music in a creative way. I was going to be like a lounge singer or whatever, and that was my experience of it, that it was something about knowing that I had a skill, but not, it wasn't going any further than that. It's painful. That's just a painful thing to know. But when I was writing, I felt I've got a chance. Mm-hmm. And with singing, I knew I didn't have a chance. I just felt a difference somehow.
How can you tell, is there a way, the recognition that you had, is there something you can tell someone to look for?
To me, the recognition is from looking at real singers. Mm. Like, I thought I have a technical big voice, so if I can out-sing the girl over there with her weird, curious voice, I must be a better singer, but that's not true. Mm. The better singer is whoever has the vision, the idea, the songwriting ability, who has the full concept. It's not just a performance, it's like an integrated thing. And I definitely, when I started writing, I thought maybe I've got exactly the same skill here as in singing, I just imitate other writers, and I did do that for a long time. And that's still a large part of my work, but I was able to add a little bit extra. That's how I felt about it, yeah.
Do you mean when you see someone else, if you know that they don't have it, or you just as it relates to yourself?
Well, no, you can run whichever direction you'd like to, but, you know, I think any of us who are creatives, it's that, you know, it's not like being a banker or a lawyer, mm-hmm. where you start and you move up a specific thing. There are ebbs and flows, yeah. and some people never flow, and some people, you know, mm-hmm. constant ebbs. And so I get asked by people, like, how do you know when you should do something else?
Yeah.
And that's such a hard question to answer. Right. It really is, because I'm just speaking for myself. It's not just there's so many components. And I don't know the answer, because sometimes, you know, I'll read something of someone's and think, yeah, they have talent, but, you know, I know someone else who, mm-hmm. It's not a unique, particularly unique voice. So do you say to that person, yeah, you have a nice voice, but it's, you know, maybe if you want to do something else, you should think about doing something else, because I don't know that you're going to get to wherever. How do you know? I don't know the answer to that.
I know a lot of really talented writers in my classes and things, and it's mysterious why some people end up continuing to write and why some don't. There's a fair amount of luck about it, and about it. Persistence is extremely important. When you know that that's really what you want to do, and you have an ability, you can't do it if you're really lousy at it, but if you have an ability and that's really what you want to do, that you know, that's what tells you that you can do it. It's the interest in it. The thing about writing is I'm just as interested, if not more, now than I was when I was 16 or 17 when I first started writing, so that it's inexhaustible to me as a source of curiosity and as something I'm trying to learn how to do. You know, that's why I know it's the right thing for me, because it recedes in front of me forever, and I keep pursuing it, and that's, you know, that's what you want.
Anything else? Do something you love and you'll never work a day in your life.
That's what my mother says.
Hi. I was wondering, when you start writing a novel, what comes first? Is it the characters or the plot? Do you sort of build your story around the characters or fitting characters into a certain plot?
For me, it's, for lack of a better word, just the voice. have a certain sense of a tone that it's going to be in. And plot and all the rest of it, I just make it up as I go along, which is probably obvious to anyone who's read my books. But I just rely on the tone fitting in some way, and then I let everything else, especially now that I'm older, be pretty subconscious, you know? I feel like I don't make notes of plot, or very, very scarce ones, because I'm kind of waiting to see what my subconscious will throw up. And when I was young, I would have been horrified by that process, but...
Can you say what you told me about the plot of your new book?
Yeah, for example, it's in 7 parts, and I just finished the 6th part, and as I finished the 6th part, I realized what the plot was going to be for the whole novel and how it was going to end. I mean, that's a long... It's got further and further back. You know, it used to be I'd know a quarter of the way through or halfway through. Now I'm almost finished before I work out what's happening. And the funny thing with this book is that even though it's so late in the day, the plot is really plotty, you know? It, like, really fits together. And that's why I have more faith in subconscious work. I think if you read lots and lots of books and you're very narratively made up, a lot of the work gets done. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't have to consciously work at it. It's weird. I would never have guessed that when I was younger, but that's been happening more and more. That just I sit down in front of think, oh, that's what happens in the plot. And it's just one moment of realizing it and then having to do the legwork of writing it all out.
We're going to take our last question.
Last night, Salman Rushdie spoke on the very same stage you're on now. I was wondering if any of you had any contact with him, worked with him, and then what do you admire about his writing particularly?
Did he ask you to ask this question? No. I'm glad this is a stage. It feels like a pit, actually, more than a stage. We know him well. You know him well. We both know him well, yeah.
Do you want to take it?
Well, he was, when I read Midnight's Children, I took a year off from college and traveled around the world and ended up in India. And that was the same year that Midnight's Children was first published, or maybe it was in paperback then. And I read it and I thought it was amazing. And because I was young and reckless, I ended up coming back from Calcutta through London. And I looked in the phone book to see if this guy, Salman Rushdie, was in the phone book. And he was. And I went out to his house and knocked on his door to tell him that I loved his book. First time I'd ever done that for a writer. And the door opened, and a woman who was his mother-in-law opened the door. And she said, oh, no, he's in Italy. Because now he was a big success, he wasn't in London anymore, he's like in the Riviera or something. And so I said, well, can I leave a note for Mr. Rushdie? And she said, yes. I went into his house, and for some reason I had 10 rupees in my pocket that I'd brought back from India as a souvenir. So I just wrote, I don't remember what I wrote, you know, I loved your book, etc. And I put the rupees in the envelope, and I left them for him. And I was sure that he would get in he would contact me, because how, you know, what devotion I had shown to go to his house, and I expected him to write me or, you know, send me flowers, and I never heard from him. And now whenever I don't respond to some nice thing that a reader, I always think back to that moment. I think, yeah, I see why he didn't write back to me. He's busy, he couldn't do it. But, you know, I met him years later. I told him that I'd been in his house, and, you know, it was obviously before the fatwa, so it was not a problem of my infiltrating his doorstep.
I didn't know that story. That's
yeah.
When I was in college, I had a friend who I ended up being a roommate with after college, and his mum was a friend of Rushdie's, because it was Cambridge, right? It's that kind of place. And she knew I wanted to be a writer, and she invited me to dinner, and Rushdie was there. And I'd never met a writer. I mean, I was completely out of my mind. I couldn't believe it. And I had also read Midnight's Children, and it really had a big influence on White Teeth. And you can feel it, just the rhythm of it. And I sat next to him, and he has that strange finger. He has a strange nail. I didn't say a word all night. I just stared at his nail for like an hour and a half.
That's in Midnight's Children. That he gets
right.
Bit off.
And then I went home. I was like, well, that's a fucking disaster. And then I finished the book about 2 years later. And I don't know how it came about. I didn't, it must have been this boy's mother. I must have sent her a copy and she sent it to him. Mm-hmm. And then I came home one day, because I was tutoring, trying to make money in between. And I put in the answer machine and it was Salman. I was like 22.
Oh my God.
I rushed on my answer machine. I had friends around. We were all like, oh, just kept on playing this message. Playing. He just said something like, I read your book. I thought it was so funny and nice. And it was unbelievable to me. I haven't thought about that in a long time, but it reminds me that Salman is incredibly generous to young writers.
Yeah, I was going to say that he is, yeah.
Most writers of his age don't, you know, they don't read first novels, they don't have time for them, or they see them in this competitive way. And Salman reads everything and is hugely supportive, and he put a quote on the back of White Teeth, and it made all the difference, I'm sure, in selling it and going to different countries. And but it was that answer machine message really blew my mind. It was terrific. God bless him.
So we want to thank our guests, Jeffrey Eugenides, Zadie. Thanks for joining us. Have a good night.